Hello again. Surprise. It's Pete and Jeff
great
here.
Great to be back.
Again, we're great to be back. I now have a chair-shaped behind because I've been sitting in this chair all day. And I think they make these chairs deliberately uncomfortable just for all of us that have to sit here all day. Anyway, so thank you again for joining us. Today's this talk that we're going to be doing next is going to be on point of sale, our point of service stuff. But first, I noticed that just in the time that it took me to go and grab a drink here, that the printer was like, can we get a shot of that? Some people are already raided the printer. See, look, all that's left is one lone. So somebody has a five-wheeled train around here somewhere, and I'm not sure who it is, but
those wheels are tough to get off. Yeah, so I've heard.
Yeah, so you've heard, right? I think I see it over there. So, yeah, okay, that's what I thought. So people have rated that already. If you missed it, we had been 3D printing here during the day. Mm-hmm. We 3D printed out a model. And we've also been talking about Bluetooth. The last section was about Windows Embedded. So we talked about a number of things you can do with Windows Embedded. And this particular unit is going to be on point of service, which is related to Windows Embedded, but it's not necessarily doesn't necessarily require Windows Embedded. So this is something that works just with Windows 8.1 and through the new point of service APIs. So, I mean, you've been to the store once or twice, right?
Yep.
And you go there and people are scanning stuff all the time. Mm-hmm. You know, that's just the way stores operate. And so I've got this device here. You don't need to get a close-up of it. It's not that exciting. I showed this at the beginning of the day, and I said this is probably one of the least geeky toys I've ever bought to attach to a PC. Now I can scan things. So what can you do with this? Well, I can scan things. I can shoot lasers. There we go. I can do cool light shows. I don't know if any of that will come off. You can do stuff like this. Anyway, so, but if you're doing stuff in retail or you're doing stuff, again, in medical or other places, being able to access these devices from Windows is a big deal, right? That's something that we haven't had the ability to do before for modern apps. So let's talk a little bit about that. So barcode readers, scanners, credit card readers, all of these things are being increasingly used in retail. I've mentioned before that you can have some embedded devices with the stuff built into it. Ultimately, it's going to use these same APIs, whether it's physically connected to the device or whether it's tethered via USB, like this particular thing that I have here. But you see this, when you go to the hospital, you're a barcode, right? Mm-hmm. Was it Riddick that had the barcode tattooed on his neck? One of those guys had a barcode. So in the future, I guess people will be barcoded. Rental cars often have very large barcodes on them. You see the 2D barcodes everywhere, or the QR codes and other types of barcodes everywhere. If you're a delivery guy, they have it's not a QR code, but it is I'm not sure what they're called. Somebody knows what they're called. But they're a very rich barcode where it has all the information about the delivery built onto it itself. But it is a series of dots over a field. It's not just a simple barcode. What we're going to be showing here are the straight barcodes like you might find on products. But there are certainly devices that support all these different kinds of scanners, and those are supported on Windows. So Windows apps can interface with key point of sale and service devices. And the reason why I say key here is because we don't support everything right out of the box. Again, this is a new API. And so what we support is the HID point of sale API. So the devices must support that. And before you go and buy, 10,000 of a particular device, just check with us to make sure that the device itself is compatible with these APIs, because we have guys on the product teams that will know those types of things. The windows.devices.pointofservice namespace has two key classes that you're going to be working with. It has the barcode scanner class, and it has the magnetic stripe reader class. And the magnetic stripe reader class, of course, you think credit card, but it's also hotels, right? I mean, they have their keys for doing different stuff there. There are lots of places where those types of stripe readers come in place. If you're paying for parking on the way out of the garage, you're probably going to want one, an embedded operating system, but then also have one of these magstripe readers as part of that, so you can just put your ticket in, put your credit card in, and be done with it, right? If you want to access a default barcode scanner, you can. It's funny because somebody earlier gave me a hard time for this code, and now I understand what they were annoyed with my if scanner is null type thing here. You just call the get default async method on the barcode scanner class. That's going to give you the default scanner. And if that scanner it doesn't equal null, then you're able to do something with that, right? So really simple code that one of the intrepid viewers earlier gave me a hard time about for, I guess, for good reason. So, and they said they hate that code, hate it, and wanted me to change it before I do this. Mm-hmm. So very, very involved reader in that case. So, and this one wins the award for the longest class name I've ever seen. The class name is so long that my picture is overlapping the end of this class name. The Magnetic Stripe Reader Bank Card Data Received Event ARGS. ARGS. Okay? So, thank goodness that we have the ability to use names that are longer than 8 characters. Unlike this is not a COBOL type class. So you wouldn't be able to fit that in there. Or at least the classic stuff that I learned. Maybe the other stuff is different. So what you're going to do for if you want to read the bank card data, you're going to call the, first, if you want to update the UI, you have to dispatch the call. But you're going to get the account number and expiration date and all that stuff through that ARGS class, and you're going to be able to read that. And cool, we have a demo here. And so we have our cool fade in on that. And so what I wanted to do here is show a little bit of the scanner. I'm not going to do any barcode reader stuff, but I do have some scanner stuff. So let me get out of this for a second. And if you want to go back over to this PC, I have here, if it pops up, there we go. I have here the app for setting up this particular device. Now, you don't actually need this app on the machine, but it is set up in such a way that you are able to configure the different devices. This is provided by the manufacturer. So in this case, I have an SG20T as a device. So I can hit OK on that. And then it has all the different ways that I can configure it. And the way that it works is it sends out, it creates a barcode that you then scan. So if I want this to run in keyboard mode, what I can do is I can open up a notepad here so I'll be able to do this. If I want this to run in keyboard mode, all I have to do is, and if you can see this on the camera here, all I need to do is aim it at that barcode and scan it, and now the barcode reader is in keyboard mode. So as somebody who doesn't deal with these things a lot, I thought that was a pretty novel way to program these. I'm sure folks have been doing this forever, think nothing of it. So now I've got this in keyboard mode. Do we have something we can scan? Do we have? No. Wait. I see something. Oh, let me not sit on my cords here. Turn around.
All right.
I think there was something. I think you left the tag on your shirt here. There we go. So there we go. So now we saw that it's the end of the day, folks. So now you saw that we actually got the code here. Thanks for pulling it off. Can you hold that tag just for a second?
So it works on any barcode.
Yeah. So here's the characters that came through. What I want to do here is I want to use that same, you can set that aside. I'm going to change this to be hid point of sale, if you look at the screen here. So I do that, it's going to generate a second barcode. Just put this in hid point of sale mode. Come on. There we go. All right, so now it's blinking for me, and it's ready to be in hid point of sale mode. So now if I scan the barcode, can we have that same barcode for a second?
Actually, I think I do have one more barcode for us.
This is
a can of refreshing cola.
Yes,
so,
I see.
So it happens to have a barcode on the back of it right there. So do you want to...
So very good. So this can of refreshing cola, which is following the branding rules of that we have here. Let me see if I can. Let's see. I hit start scanner. Let's see if it works here. There we go.
It actually. Look at that.
So I'll explain some of the other gobbledygook in here, but the number on this is 0494038, which you can see there right in the middle of the barcode. Right. Okay. Thank you for your refreshing cola.
All right. Let's try it out. Make sure it's.
Still refreshing.
Refreshing.
Now let me see the other tag that you have there, the one that you yanked off the back of your neck, since you don't have the official Microsoft employee barcode tattooed on yet. there we go. So cool. And now I think we're both qualified to be store employees.
Okay.
So I've had my training for today. So you see again the stuff scanned in here. So let me show the code for this. Let me get that out of the way. I'm trying to make sure the laser is aimed at the cameras, just like I said before. That way we mess you guys up. Let me open this up and look at the code. There's some stuff here that I think you're going to see you know, that's somewhat similar to some of the other things that we have before. So the first thing is I call the barcode scanner's get default async method to get the default barcode scanner on the machine. You're not limited to just one. So just like all the other APIs we talked about today, you can use device selectors and, you know, pick out, you know, one or more of those scanners, which that might be useful if you think like you're at a retail at a store and you might have a fixed one. And then I know when I go to unnamed big box store where you buy lumber and other stuff, they often have a handheld one that they need to go over and scan as well. So those things could actually be connected to the same device. Then you need to claim the scanner, which is interesting. This is a little different from some of the other stuff before, but it is very similar to, say, connecting to a Bluetooth device or connecting to USB. By claiming the scanner, you're now, you know, interfacing with it from the app. And then whenever data is received, we get an event. And then all you have to do after that is you just call the code to enable async. So, you know, enable this particular scanner. I'm looking at the camera while I'm saying scanner. The amount of code here, if you look, we have get default async, we do a null check, and then really there's, so get default, claim, and enable, and then wire up an event handle. And that's all there is to doing a barcode. It's actually quite simple. And then when data comes in, you're gonna get a buffer. So you need to be able to work with buffers. This is, again, a common pattern across many of these device APIs in Windows. The buffer comes through as the scan data. And then what you do is read the string from that, in this case, the scan data, for the full length of that. Now, what I did here is I'm using the full scan data, but there are other fields that are available to us. So for example, scan data label and some other ones might be more appropriate, because a lot of times that includes just the scanner information itself without the additional, checksums and other stuff that came across as, I think there's some sort of Chinese characters or something there on that screen. Mm-hmm. You won't have to worry about getting that stuff with it. You can just get that. But it all depends on what the barcode scanner is reporting back to the APIs. And then you can also get type information from that as well. All right. Now, finally, in order to update the UI, because this is a callback, in order to update the UI, I need to dispatch this. So this is there something like when you're working in HTML, so a legit question, I'm actually just live question here, I don't know something about it, the JavaScript. When you're working in JavaScript and you want to interface with, you don't have to dispatch something to move to update the UI, do you?
No.
Because there's no, and this wasn't a loaded question actually, but there's no, like, you don't have the background threading and stuff to worry about.
Right. Okay. We have a single UI thread, you just update the UI directly.
Okay. In this case, the on data received event is on a background thread. And if you're a developer who's worked in XAML and stuff before, you'll be familiar with the idea of anything that's on a background thread, if it wants to interact with the UI, you need to dispatch that. So the dispatcher in Windows 8.1 is a little different from the dispatcher we had before, but it is still pretty simple to use. You just call the run async method, and then you pass that in as some sort of a delegate, and that adds that label to the UI. So then the final thing is just, when the app starts, I just initialize the scanner when I click that. Now, interesting little tidbit here, and this took lots of debugging over the past weekend, where I was sort of banging my head against this, because it's really a very simple demo. But if I put the call to initialize the scanner here inside the constructor of the page, even after initialize component, the scanner would not be found. So that's really interesting. There's some sort of a race condition or something that happens there where I perhaps need to use a loaded event or some other mechanism to check. But usually after initialize component, all the stuff is built and the UI is built and XAML is ready for you to work with it. But in this case, in order to initialize that scanner, I need to make sure I put it in something else. So keep that in mind when you are working with that. Now, let me open up this for a second. So the other thing that you need to keep in mind, and I realize now I didn't point out the app manifest in some of the other sessions. So I will, for the folks that have been watching all day, I'm going to go back and show you something else here in just a second. That's really, I think, important. Inside the device capabilities in the app manifest, you need to specify point of service. Now, you can't do this from the AppX manifest UI. You have to go in and edit the XML directly, and you have to do the same thing for Bluetooth and the same thing for the other HID stuff. You have to edit that directly. There is an M2 namespace, which for the other ones is required, but for this was optional. But you see where it says under capabilities, where you would put, say, internet client and other stuff, there is a device capability that's called point of service. So actually, before we continue on anything else, let me quickly pull up one of the other demos. So the Bluetooth iRacer demo is probably a good example of this, where I want to show you what was inside that AppX manifest. because this can trip people up, because it's not always obvious when you're looking at the examples on the internet. So right here, under capabilities, so I have internet client, which isn't strictly necessary for this app. Underneath that, inside the M2 namespace, which is defined at the top, so you get IntelliSense because it has a namespace declared in there, I needed to say, this one was the iRacer demo where I was controlling the little race car over Bluetooth. I needed to specify bluetooth.rfcom, and then I would allow any device to connect. This is where you can specify classes of devices. And then the function type is serial port, which is the serial port profile under RFCOM. So keep that in mind when you're working with any of the device stuff that we had today. Take a look on MSDN where each of these things are documented. You'll see that there's Bluetooth as well as point of service and other stuff. All are documented under the APEX manifest pages for what are the additional settings that you need to have for these devices. If you do not have the APEX manifest settings put in there, what will happen is the calls to initialize will just fail. Like they fail pretty silently. Or what happens is when you try to get the default device, it returns null instead of returning the appropriate device. So definitely some good stuff to keep in mind there. All right. And actually, this was a pretty short talk here today. Mm-hmm. So I think it's kind of fun here to mess around with these scanners. I mean, if you're in the retail world or, again, you're doing medical stuff or something, this is a really easy API to work with. And again, you can connect this directly to any Windows PC. I believe it also runs on ARM devices. I need to double check that. I believe it also runs on ARM devices if it's following the HID point of sale API, so it uses the inbox drivers. And the HID point of sale stuff is actually a standard, so it's not something that we've invented. This is a standard out there, so you'll find that there's going to be increasing adoption from these different device manufacturers. Plus, if you're truly a geek, you can... Sort of has that phaser look to it, right?
It does look like a phaser.
Cool. All right. Well, thank you very much for that. And I think we're going to take the next session here just very shortly. We'll do a little recap of some of the things that we learned today. And then as an added bonus, we're going to talk about some of the performance testing in Visual Studio and also HTML and XAML apps as well, to some performance considerations for that. So thank you.
Thank you.